everyone. My name is Valerie and I am the Outreach Coordinator for Future Energy Systems. Today we're going to be reading Heroes of the Environment, True Stories of People Who Are Helping to Protect Our Planet by Harriet Rohmer and illustrated by Julie McLaughlin. We're going to be reading Chapter 4, Bringing Solar Power to Indigenous Communities. And this is about Debby Tewa, a solar electrician from the Hopi Reservation in Arizona. Until she was 10 years old, Debby Tewa lived with her grandmother in a three-room stone house in a remote area of the Hopi Reservation in Arizona. She remembers exploring the desert with her cousins and swimming in little ponds. Like other families around them, Debby and her grandmother never had running water, or a telephone, or electrical power. For heating, cooking, and lighting, they used coal, wood, and kerosene. "I didn't miss electricity then," Debby recalls. "I didn't know that I didn't have it." Debby is a solar electrician and a light bringer. She brings electric light and power to some of the most isolated places on the Hopi and Navajo reservations, communities like the one where she grew up. "I can identify with the people I'm helping," she says. "I really understand their excitement when they turn on a light for the first time." Hopi Land has been home to Debby's family for many generations. It is a beautiful, dry desert environment with three major mesas, rocky tables of land, that rise as high as 7,200 feet, nearly 2,200 meters. Surrounding the mesas are low-altitude deserts and gullies. Most people live either in the 12 traditional villages on top of the mesas or in modern communities below. The high mesa villages are famous around the world for their culture and long history. Old Oribi, for example, is believed to be the oldest continuously inhabited community in the United States, established more than 850 years ago, around the year 1150. Many Hopi households are connected to the electrical grid, which means they get electricity from the power company's lines, like most city dwellers around the country. But several hundred households on the 1.6 million acre or 647,000 hectare reservation are too far away from power lines to hook into the grid. Debby was in the fourth grade and living with her parents off the reservation when she first had electricity at home. "I liked being able to study at night and watch TV," she remembers. She started thinking about how she could help bring electricity to places like her grandmother's community. After graduating at the top of her class from Sherman Indian High School in California, Debby returned to the Hopi Reservation, where she took a job helping other young people find summer work. One day, a woman came to the office to recruit boys to attend trade school. "Can girls go too?" Debby asked. When the woman said yes, Debby jumped at the chance. "We could choose either plumbing or electricity," Debby remembers. "At first I chose plumbing because I was scared of electricity. Then a couple of Hopi classmates wanted me to come over to electricity. They promised they would help me out if I did, and sure enough, they did help. Later, she got to help them when they worked together on jobs. I'm lucky because I've always had a lot of support for what I'm doing." Debbie's next big opportunity came in 1987 when the Hopi Foundation, created by Hopi people to improve life on the reservation, started an organization called Native Sun. The idea was to bring energy to isolated Hopi communities in a way that would fit in with their traditional way of life. Solar energy seemed like the perfect solution. It didn't cause the pollution and health problems that coal power plants did. It was silent, it was easy to install, and it required very little maintenance. Best of all, since the energy was coming from the sun, it was renewable energy, meaning the supply wouldn't get used up. Solar power would also enable Hopi households to be energy independent, because they wouldn't have to rely on energy from power companies outside their land. To spread the word about solar energy, the Hopi Foundation recruited several members of the tribe who could speak the Hopi language. One of them was Debby Tewa. Part of Debbie's job was to teach people about solar energy, how to choose the right solar electric system, how to use it, and how to take care of it. I wanted them to feel like it was theirs, but first she had to get people interested. Solar panels are made of many solar cells. When sunlight strikes the solar cells, the energy causes the electrons in the cell's atoms to break free from the nuclei they orbit. These free electrons then flow into an energy current. Electricity is stored in batteries connected to the solar panels, so the system still works at night and on cloudy days. Debby set up demonstration solar power systems in three villages on the mesas. People came to see how solar panels could be wired into their houses so they could have electricity. A 90-year-old woman was amazed that she could flick a switch and a light would come on. A seamstress could use an electric sewing machine. Kids could do homework and watch TV at night. And they didn't have to pay for the new system all at once because Native Sun offered loans to their customers. When people wanted to try it out, Debby loaned them a small trailer-mounted system for a week. This helped them to decide how large of a system they wanted, and then Debby would drive out and install it. She would strap on her tool belt, climb up a ladder onto the roof, and go to work. Sometimes she would be on top of a 200-year-old stone house, looking out over hundreds of miles of low desert and high mesas. In the next few years, Debby installed more than 300 solar panels on Hopi houses, and the people on the reservation started calling her Solar Debby. She also installed solar panels on the neighboring Navajo reservations and trained other electricians, especially women, in places as far away as Ecuador and South America. Debby has 4 solar panels on her own house on the reservation. That's enough for lights and TV. It's not like the power lines bring, she says, but it's enough. For people like Debbie's aunt and her aunt's 90-year-old neighbor who have never had electricity before, solar power has made a life-changing difference. They no longer have to read by the light of a propane lamp. But best of all, they know that they have control over their own electricity. When you get your own solar electrical system, it's yours, Debby explains. You are not dependent on a power company. With solar energy, you can be independent. And that's the story of Debby Tewa, a solar electrician from the Hopi Reservation in Arizona. Have any of you grown up without power? Can you imagine what that would be like? For Debby, that experience inspired her to help her communities as she grew up. Have you guys been inspired by anyone who's helping their communities? Or are you yourself trying to help your community? Think about that, and also check out our extension activities below. We'll see you next week for our next story time. Bye! Thank you so much for watching Future Energy Systems video. Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss any of our exciting content. Check out the links below to our website and learning page where you can find activities, learning extension, and more. You can also sign up on the website for notifications for future videos and interactive opportunities. There's so much to learn as we explore our energy future.